This, I haven't even bothered to change the date. I was asked once in June 2016 to give a short talk about managing bits of DNS with Ansible, and I thought, when we talked about coming here, I thought, okay, well, I'll bring this along. Now, this is not a very polished thing, just, as I say, just a few notes, a few things. I was going to give a small introduction about DNS. Everybody knows what the DNS, what the domain name system is? Yeah, and you all know about authoritative service and recursive service and all that?
Good,
very good. Then I don't have to explain that. So, a very fast overview over authoritative service, recursive service, are different kettle of fish, but authoritative service, we have NSD4, created by NLNet Labs, and it's extremely fast, has a number of things that it supports, TSIG, transaction signatures, DNSSEC. Who does DNSSEC? Okay. It sort of compiles zones, it more or less pre-compiles zones. It operates as a root server. In fact, it was originally created as a root name server to augment or to have a different brand of DNS server than just the bind. And it has add zone and del zone support since NSD4. NSD3 is not worth talking about anymore since NSD4. And a couple other interesting things, including RRL, which is rate limiting. So a very, very fast authoritative-only server. Authoritative-only means it can only answer questions authoritatively. It does not recurse. You can't use it to look up google.com unless you're google.com. Bind, version 9, who knows or who uses Bind? Okay. An excellent piece of kit, still is and probably always will be. You might be surprised to hear me say that, but it's almost impossible to beat Bind 9. Bind 9 is extremely interesting because it is a full reference implementation of anything that has ever been created in the DNS world, which, by the way, is also a reason why Bind 9 is, to a certain extent, problematic, and why it has a number of security, or it has had a number of security issues, because it is so feature-rich. And because it is so widely deployed, it's very hard to say, but probably in the order of about 95% of all DNS servers worldwide, are Bind 9 servers. So that presents, of course, a huge wall of attack surfaces where Bind 9 has in the past had admittedly a number of quite severe problems. What? Yes.
Why is there no decision that we shouldn't use the same version everywhere?
Yeah, monoclonal.
Well, it's like me trying to force other people to use Ansible instead of using Puppet. You can't force people to.
Not saying that you should force them, but I don't understand why there is no consensus about them that they should at least not have this monoclonal because. We all know what
one reference implementation. If you want a new feature, you need
it's
a reference implementation.
It's very easy. If you want to use, for example, dynamically loadable zones, and you want DNS updates, and you want RPZ, there's only exactly one product that you can use, and that is Bind version 9. Yeah.
But so, I was thinking about the root name server.
The root name server is a different kettle of fish. We have at the moment the 13 root server installations. These 13 root server installations, hundreds of machines. Many of them use Bind 9. I think there's a nominum in between. Is there a nominum?
It's not only Bind 9.
There's NSC. Oh, no.
Okay.
Czech, the .cz have produced, I'll tell you about it in a moment, the not DNS server. It's all puns on the word Bind. No? To bind me in English means to tie. Yeah. Knot is a knot, a shoelace. And Unbound is a recursive server created by NLNet Labs. There are different flavors, particularly for the root servers. But of course, when people want to publish authoritative DNS, then they choose the implementation that they are comfortable with or that they prefer working. But Bind 9 is a wonderful piece of code. There's no question about it. A full reference implementation is Bind 9 is That is a bit unfortunate. On the other hand, sometimes it's nice to have, but you shouldn't use it. Bind 9 can be used as an authoritative and a recursive server in one binary. Please don't do it. You can do it at home, but otherwise don't do it. Bind 9, as I say, supports everything, runs on Windows 32, so you can have bind 9.exe, named.exe, and dig and all the utilities run on Win 32, Windows. Has support for RFC 2136, that's dynamic DNS updates. Knows about RPZ, I call it RPZ, it's officially called RPZ because it's an American term, which stands for Response Policy Zones. With RPZ we can create a zone file, which looks like a DNS zone file, it's just that the data looks a bit strange, so no IP addresses in it. They're just basically just C names, which either end in a dot or end in a name, and with RPZ I can create a recursive server which, for example, for your organization would prohibit you want to prohibit people going to weather.yahoo.com. You can fake that into 127.0.0.1, or you can hide a complete zone, or you can translate zones, things like that. That's doable with RPZ. Views are possible. Views is about the worst thing that you can ever do. I will refuse to talk to you if you use views. Views allow you to, in one server, in one binary, provide different responses depending on what network you're coming from. Okay, it's really super easy to debug, especially when you have people who want to do a zone transfer from this view into this view. That's really, really cool. A resource rate limiting catalog zones is something very new in Bind 9.11. Catalog zones are the possibility to, when you have an authoritative bind server, for example, and a whole bunch of slave servers, and you provision a new zone, a new authoritative zone, you want to also provision that master zone onto all your slaves, onto all your secondaries. And so far it was basically necessary to script that in some way. You could use add zone or NDC add zone to add it, but it had to be scripted. With catalog zones, you can make an entry dynamically, also make an entry into this catalog, which is just a DNS zone. Bind 9 transfers the zone. This secondary servers, all bind 9, recognize the catalog zone, see what's in it, say, oh, I have to create a new zone, create the zone automatically and slave it in. So within milliseconds, you create a new zone and it's available on the slaves. Bind 9.10 existed, note the tense, please. Was a huge project created by ISC and also some Dutch colleagues. But it was killed. Bind 9 was a combination of C++, Python 3. It was supposed to bring everything new, was supposed to be modular, but it turned into a huge eater of money, and B, into a product that just wasn't feasible. So it was basically killed. It still exists, the code still exists as Bundy DNS. Slightly maintained by Carsten Schlottmann, but not really worth it. Don't waste your time with it. That's my opinion, of course. PowerDNS? Anybody know PowerDNS? Okay, PowerDNS authoritative server, also a wonderful piece of kit. Completely different, has basically different backends, mainly database backends, so MySQL, Oracle, PostgreSQL, LDAP, also pipe backends. So when you have a bind server, and the bind server, for example, comes up with very, very many thousands of zones, it reads them all in, it compiles them, it has to load them into RAM, takes a lot of time. The bind server is deaf while it starts. I'm talking about many, many, many tens of thousands of zones. I have seen a bind server which required 45 minutes to launch, okay? But this was really pretty huge. And somehow they were about 500,000 zones. That's a lot of stuff. PowerDNS authoritative server is a server that, for example, you can stuff a million zones into a MySQL database, and when you launch PowerDNS, it just starts and it's there because it doesn't do anything. It waits until it gets a query, goes back to the database, checks does it have a record, yeah? Select from a database table where name is whatever, example.com, and returns the answer. PowerDNS authoritative today in version, I think think release 404, and at the moment is 4.1.0 release candidate 2 or 3. excellent piece of kit, in particular if you want to do DNSSEC signing. There is nothing easier in the terms of providing DNSSEC signed zones than using PowerDNS authority. Okay, so that's just a little bit. Oh, here, NOT. NOT was created by the .cz top level domain, Czech Republic. Is a master and slave server, supports a lot of the basic DNS features, zone transfer, so AXFR, IXFR, of course, incremental zone transfer, dynamic updates also, also add zone, delete zone, reconfiguration, DNSSEC. So all the important things that also NSD or bind will support. And I believe it's also used as a root server, but I can't remember which one or which implementation. Also, of course, the DNSSEC and signing. Yeah, so nice, also nice piece. So you all know about Ansible. This is the picture that I was telling you about this morning. We saw something very, very similar, but with AWX, so a few more modules. Okay, and then let's talk about the actual, or the original topic was DNS. So how to, for example, install DNS software. There are obviously everything that you can do manually with the packaging module, so apt or yum or zip or whatever, or the package module. Do you know the package module in Ansible? Okay, I only learned about it recently. It's cool, in particular when you say gather facts, false. Try it. And then you have installation from Galaxy. Galaxy, anybody, you all know what Ansible Galaxy is? Who likes Ansible Galaxy? Or who could, not like, who thinks it's valuable?
To look for examples.
To look for, no, to look for examples, it's good. For anything else, it's...
To host my own roles on.
I wouldn't trust it.
Just make sure you read it.
So you can, for example, if you look for how can we install bind, try Apache first. Look for an answer. Look for an Apache role. I think they're about 8,972 and a half. Then you can choose the nicest. Here, the bind roles. This I checked. I don't know, a few months ago. Bind. We have 62 roles in Galaxy to install a bind server. 7 for NSD, which I thought was quite interesting. 14 for NOT. 24 for PowerDNS. 88 for DNS mask, which is a recursive server and DHCP server, and 11 for unbound. So let's say you want to install a not authoritative DNS server. Then you choose one of the 14 roles. Have fun. Send me a message. Send me a postcard when you're done, and tell me which one you took. And the problem, Galaxy is great for examples. I fully agree with that, and it's great to learn things. I would hate to have to use a role that I downloaded from a Galaxy unless I knew that a particular person or somebody that who I trust actually uses it. Some of these roles are, as I say, interesting to learn things from, but some roles are so configurable, and you have to read about for 45 minutes about which variables you have to set where to put what at what place, and what, where people say, fuck it, I'm going to write it myself. And that's how 8,592 Apache roles land in Galaxy. Pardon my French, but I'm thirsty.
We had the same issue, a discussion with the Windows working group. A lot of Windows roles existed before Windows implementation really worked well, and most of them are no longer necessary because there is now a module that does it. So I asked in the working group, shouldn't we get rid of these? Yeah. And they said, no, but this is community related stuff. We're not entitled to remove or do anything with those things, which means that most of those Windows roles are actually bad ways to do something, but people will stumble upon it.
The problem is that you, well, not you, of course, personally, but one is we are all, by leaving them in there, we are all adding to the confusion.
We're providing information,
we're providing documentation, we're providing code, which doesn't work, which shouldn't work, which ought not to work anymore. If Ansible.com or what is the name of the company? It's Red Hat, no?
It's Red Hat.
But they call themselves Ansible. If Ansible say we can't touch them, we can't. Okay, fine, but then put a red flag on it, or indicate somehow that this is no longer good practice.
Yeah. The official name is Ansible by Red Hat.
Yes, that's too long.
Strange.
That's too long. So, I think that is the same problem and the same bit rot that happened with Puppet Forge, it was called, I think.
Yeah.
I don't know. I haven't touched Puppet since I looked at Ansible, but. It used to be a big problem, and it's a shame to see, or it would be a great shame to see Galaxy fall into the same trap. That's why I wrote here at the bottom. Just to my mind, far too many things, and that's the reason why people write their own code, which is a good thing. But then keep it for yourself. Don't upload it again unless you really think you're very good. Who of you have ever provided a role in Galaxy? Come on, be honest.
Not a Galaxy.
I refuse to do it.
Yes, I haven't done it.
I've probably 7 or 8.
I mean, I like talking and I like helping people, and I spend a lot of time contributing to Ansible. I used to code a bit, and I spend a lot of time talking, but I refuse to be part of that. I don't want to be seen on Galaxy. I think it's a good thing, but it's badly maintained. It's not well done. Okay, after hurry up. So templating, I love templates. I love Jinja templates. If you don't do anything in Ansible, at least look at the templates. Templates are so cool. Templates can be very simple, templates can be a bit more complicated. Here is a little example of, which I did, 100 years ago, no, 7 years ago, 65 years ago. For example, generate /etc/host has nothing much to do with DNS, but it's also hostname lookup. That's why out of our inventory, we go through all the host vars. Host vars keeps a list of all variables of all hosts we've spoken to in a play, and we can collect, for example, IPv4, IPv6 addresses, and technically, factually generate /etc/host. Many of you will say, what does that have to do with DNS? Well, absolutely nothing, but it has to do with hostname resolution, and there are actually, believe it or not, environments where DNS has no place, where hostname resolution happens manually or old-fashioned style via the name service, switch. And I'm a great fan of keeping things simple, and /etc/host is a very simple technology. So whatever you do in the Ansible world, and here's an example of you saw the cake this morning. Here's an example of installing whatever we're installing here. Yeah, installing a namely.conf, so a bind configuration file. And so we're installing from a Jinja template. I call the source file is namely.conf.j2. The destination file is clear, and then we validate. And this validate namely.conf, named, so bind 9 has a utility called namely.checkconf defined above in a variable. And this program named checkconf is able to check the named configuration file on a machine. And what happens is that checkconfig is run on a file called %s. %s is the temporary file name of the template as it has been templated out onto the name server. If that checkconf program says, yo, it's okay, then the templating module goes and says, okay, now I copy to the actual final destination. Yeah? So if there are, of course, utilities which have a check configuration. Nginx has something, Apache has something, SysLogNG has something, named. There are, but you might find yourself, for example, with some Java XML thing, which you can't really check. But the very least you could do is, for example, use XML lint to verify that it actually is XML. So there are all sorts of things where you could maybe check yourself with a small shell script whether a particular keyword is in there, etc. So please validate. Remember the cake story. This here is an example of creating zone master files. Zone master files are DNS zone files, for example, for NSD, for NOT, for bind, or also for par DNS with a bind backend. Zone master files with templates. Do not want to say that I find this a good idea. I'll tell you why in a moment. But there are people who like using, I love templates, and people who like using templates for this. This is an example which I stole, more or less, stole from Resmo, Rene Moser, who is co-author of the Ansible, the second edition of the Ansible book. So he has a block at the top, a block with a head, with an origin of the zone, and SOA serial number, etc. Then we have here, we have another block with name servers, and a block with resource record sets, and here's a WW, and here's a, the address, etc. And there's a part two, and this part two, for example, uses that template and extends the base, sets an SOA serial, uses the name server block, uses the resource record set block, and adds an additional SMTP mail exchange. Now, this is explained very nicely on his blog, and you, that's the address on it, that's the URL on it. So this is one method that you can use, or that you could use, for example, Ansible templates to create zone files. I said I'm not a great fan of this. The reason I'm not a great fan of this is I'm a huge fan of dynamic updates. So I'm a huge fan of systems, DNS servers, authorities, DNS servers, which I can update dynamically using dynamic DNS updates, RFC 2136. So using the DNS protocol, I say please add a record, or please remove a whatever, name server, etc. The advantage of doing that, there are many advantages. There's some disadvantages. The user interfaces are sometimes not very sexy, but the advantage of doing that is several fold. You have automatic verification that what you're telling the name server to do is actually valid. So the name server will validate what is coming in your record before actually adding it or removing it from the zone. Second of all, whenever you perform an update, whether you update or you delete something, the SOA serial number is automatically updated. The SOA serial number updated means that servers that are conformant and correctly configured will automatically notify secondary servers who immediately go out and pull in the zone. Dynamic updates on a zone which is DNSSEC signed automatically mean that the whole zone, respectively, these records are automatically re-signed, etc. So there are a number of reasons which to do that, but if you like templating out master files, then this is a nice way of doing it, and a flexible way of doing it. Yeah, that's why I write, just because you can template doesn't mean you should. I mean, I'm a great fan of the templating engine, and Jinjutsu too, but not necessarily for this, but I wanted to talk about it again. So either RFC 2136 dynamic updates, or an API, for example, if you look at Power DNS authoritative server, they have a REST API, which is okay. I mean, it works well, with which you can do that. Or, for example, PowerDNS, if you have a MySQL backend, you can directly update the database in the background with SQL update, delete, insert, whatever, to have a similar handling. So, what are we doing here? Oh yeah, this is something that I wrote about a couple of years back. SSH fingerprints in the DNS, particularly when they're DNSSEC signed. What I did there, this is described on my blog. You can look at it a bit more in detail. The diagram describes a bit what happens there. I used I haven't checked whether it still works in 2.4. Should not. Action plugin should still work, right? I use an action plugin to get SSH keys out of Ansible, respectively out of an Ansible connection. And these SSH keys we then added to a DNS zone. Here is an example of that. And there you are.
Sorry, gotta go. Thank you all.
Thank you for being here. Yeah, this turns into then, of course, a zone with SSH FP. SSH fingerprint key and SSH fingerprint in the DNS correctly signed and with a correctly configured SSH client means that when you connect with SSH to a host, the SSH will out of band transfer the SSH FP key, will match with the fingerprint that it got via the SSH channel from that host. If they match, it will let you in and will not say, a new SSH fingerprint, do you want to access it? None of you have ever verified that host key anyway, so you don't have to listen to me here. Okay, then another thing that happened in the DNS world with Ansible is the dig module, lookup plugin. Dag Beers was telling us earlier about lookup plugins with the, in the context of with items. I'm a great, great, huge fan of lookup plugins. In fact, if you look at the list, I think at least half are, are mine. And one of them is called dig. Guess why it's called dig? Because dig is the only, well, dig, drill are the only really true and correct DNS lookup utilities. For Christ's sakes, don't use NS lookup. So dig supports, I think, everything. DNSSEC, all records, TCP, anything you want. Yeah? And the dig lookup plugin can return data as a list. That was added by Brian Cocker, I think, so we could return a list and a lookup plugin that didn't exist until then. Dig supports all query types and so text records, A records, quarter, any whatever you want. Okay. And I understand that it's used occasionally. So delegation, we don't really have to discuss this here, we'll forget about them. Then there's, for example, a couple of modules, Ansible modules to do PowerDNS API modifications, so modifications of the database backends via the API. And here is an example where what have we done? Action PDN zone. Oh yeah, we create a master zone in PowerDNS. This has been used a couple times. Then you'll find all sorts of strange modules, like some of the ones that I've just mentioned and also created myself. I call them strange because some of these modules that we find are quite nice or maybe rather practical, but the question is, of course, will they be maintained? Will they be maintained all along? Will they go into Ansible core? Who's going to maintain them if the original maintainer, the original author dies, etc.? So if you're doing DNS and if you're starting afresh and if you want to manage your DNS with Ansible, consider using zone files, and this is my opinion, obviously, and of course consider using dynamic updates to get rid of all these possible problems.
Are there modules for dynamic updates?
I beg your pardon?
Is there a module for doing dynamic updates?
Yes, there is a module called DNS Update, which was created by yours truly in 19, I don't know,
it's
no,
as if I,
something.
I asked the question and you already put a slide on it.
Voice recognition.
It was 7.9.
And this worked very well. So I wrote this because, as I say, I'm a great fan of dynamic updates, so RFC 2136, so I wrote this. And I proposed it to Ansible, and Ansible said, at the project at the time, said, I think actually it was Michael Dehan, who said, no, too specialized, which is fine, no problem.
1,300 modules later.
But what surprised me then, here's an example use, no? DNS update with a key, you specify a secret, you specify an end name, a zone, a domain, what you want to add here, for example, the A record is an EC2 IP address, etc., and then operation add, remove, delete, whatever. This is on GitHub, obviously, and it works perfectly well with Bind, with Knot, and with PowerDNS. These authoritative, these are the three open source DNS servers which have support for dynamic DNS updates. So when the Ansible project decided it's not really useful for mainstream, I thought, okay, yeah, fair enough. Which then, though, what though then surprised me a little bit is that half a year later or a year later or something, NS Update showed up on the scene. NS Update is today a core module which does dynamic DNS updates. So, okay, times change. And the usage and the options are more or less the same. Here in this example, I'm removing a record called puppet.example.net. because we don't need that anymore, right? So NS update is today a core module. I don't know whether it's supported or not, but it's at least in Ansible Core. You know, some of the modules are, what are they called? Some of the modules are core maintained and
yeah, you have community modules, core modules. I think that goes.
Okay, it's, anyway, if you install Ansible 2.4.0 today, you will find NS update. I do not recall who updates it or who maintains it, but it works very well and that's fine. Yeah, so there are other modules, specialized modules, like for example, PowerDNS recursor module or PDNS Ansible module to install PowerDNS recursor or PowerDNS apart. Depending, look at the location of this. This is maintained or at least was created by the PowerDNS project. This was done by Peter Lexis. And so the hope is, of course, that they will then also maintain this stuff if it dies. So these, maybe these modules are also on
Galaxy,
thank you, yeah. But I don't know whether they are or not.
But you can add modules to a row nowadays, and it's possible that Ansible as a project will say that all community modules should go into Galaxy. Because they don't want to in the core product anymore, because...
Fair enough. But you could, away from the beginning, you could add modules alongside your playbook in a directory called library.
Yeah.
Which I use quite frequently, actually.
So in rules.
Yeah, whatever you do, as I say, these are just a few notes. So whatever you do, if you add DNS servers, for example, to some project of yours, for goodness sakes, please don't default anything to quad 8 or quad 9 or whatever. Give users choice, okay? Don't do things like this. Yeah, DNS name servers here, and this is a snippet I cut out from somewhere. I won't tell you where I cut it out, but it is Ansible related. And it says here DNS name servers that default to 8.8.8.8.8.8.4.4, who knows what that is? So please, let's cut off. Yes, 8.8.8.8.8.4.4 are the Google DNS service, a wonderful, wonderful service, no question about it. But for Christ's sake, give me the choice, okay? Don't nail that in somewhere and don't hide it from me. Give me the choice. And of course, if you want to be really, really cool, you use Quad 9.9.9.9, which is a new service which everybody is flocking to at the moment instead of using their own infrastructure. Okay, this doesn't matter. Yeah, this is a text record. Yeah, so just a few notes, not really a presentation in that respect, but just a few notes about things that I happen to stumble over with DNS and Ansible. Any questions? It's already 20 to 6, so I have to cut it short. Anybody have any questions? Good. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.